So part of what we try to do here at StarToon is provide some tangible resources to the creators at home. For you guys at home who are starting out and trying to actually make this stuff for us, we want to make sure that you have a little bit of information regarding the technology involved in what you're doing. So to that end, I brought somebody along today who's far more qualified than myself, Chris Forney. Maybe Chris, you can tell us a little bit about who you are, what you do.
I have a lot of experience coming into studios and improving on the tools and acting as a technical director. The title kind of means a bunch of different things at a bunch of different places.
Right.
But ultimately it's to help the artists work better, smarter, and produce better content in the
yeah.
end. So whatever means it takes, whatever software it takes, you're always trying to make people focus on what they need to focus on, which is the art, telling stories, making character animation. And not have them worry about the tedium
right.
that the software sometimes brings.
Right. Right. Okay. Yeah. So I mean, I guess the broad strokes is that like the industry standards in Canada, certainly Flash, which is now called
Animate.
Yeah, pretty
broad term. Yeah.
Yeah. Flash and Harmony tend to be the more prevalent tools in this country
for 2D.
For 2D, for sure. Yeah.
Flash is one of these ones that people found a way to approach it cheap, and it produced what they expected it to produce. And it kind of revitalized the industry for a bit. There was a lull, and then Flash hit, and everyone's doing this cutout animation. The cool thing about Flash is people found these ways to push it and do more traditional-like content.
Mm-hmm.
But the scary thing with Flash is like you'll hear the word flashy thrown about, and it's almost created its own look.
Yeah, I mean, we're Canadian animation is largely defined by that as a tool.
Yeah, and you'll hear people say, oh, that looks like Canadian animation because they can tell the tool.
So if we were looking at some pros and cons
yes.
of some of these various software that are available, we start with Flash.
Flash is, it doesn't hold your hand. It really doesn't hold your hand. You can get in there, you can muck things up pretty well, but you can also just go and do what you need to do at any point. If you get some good builds, some studios do really clean builds and have giant libraries, that kind of stuff can help you.
Yeah.
And if you're comfortable with just doing frame by frame animation, it's there. You can you can jump in and do that. Its weakness is like it doesn't have very good textures. So if you get in there, you're doing almost a marker
mm-hmm.
cleanup. That's what you get from it. It's very cut and dry. Gradients you can use, but you'll see stepping in it. You'll see a few issues along the way. And it becomes a little bit heavier. It will not look like paper. It's very clean in the end.
Yeah,
it's sterile.
It's a vector tool.
Yeah.
Really sharp edges, which is great because you can get it really tight. You can pull it really far. Like it preserves its line in
yeah,
that way.
Yeah, yeah. The reuse is great too.
Yeah.
Like if you want to do a cut-in, you can
yeah.
literally do it on the same scene. So if you find that you're using Flash and it does hold you back or it does define the style and it's not the style you want to use,
right.
use a different piece of software.
Right. But it's affordable.
Yes, it's like $20 a month now, which
yeah.
is super easy, yeah. super cheap.
So for the average animator, Flash is pretty much what we tend to expect.
It's the simplest one to get for
yeah.
an individual generally. Like you can just sign up, throw your credit card in and download it type
yeah.
thing. And you see it maybe 4 or 5 coffees in a week or in a month. And that's how much
yeah.
it costs you. It's not that bad.
Yeah.
But I mean, a lot of these software packages are coming out with a monthly cost.
Mm.
So if you know what your budget is, if you know that you have certain needs that need to be done with the software or your certain tools that you want to use, there's definitely affordable ways to get them
right.
with these monthly packages. Harmony is another good example for that, moving on to something very Flash-like. If you take Flash renders, it's done, and there's not much polish on it. Harmony is a good example where it is more designed. It has bells and whistles.
It's a filmmaking tool.
Yeah,
yeah.
There's things that make your job easier, your life a little bit nicer in general to problem solve the issues that are going to come up in the cutout animation. It's a little bit more expensive, but it means that you can now render out and do compositing in the same piece of software.
Okay.
So where you would need, let's say, Flash and then After Effects in another pipeline,
yeah.
you could do most of that stuff with Harmony by itself. The compositing is built right into it. there's deformations. So if you want to do crazy noodly arm characters, mm-hmm. that's a little bit easier to do in Harmony than Flash. And if you have a show that you're comfortable doing the bare bones or Flash style suits it, go for Flash, aim for Flash. If you want more options, want more polish, there's other options. Harmony's a good example. If you go to their site, they have tutorials on how to rig, how to do cutout animation, how to do traditional style animation, and how to comp. So they're definitely aiming more towards the individual users at this point. Yeah. And I think it's the right direction. I think they're doing a good job in moving that way. But Flash is also moving that way. So find a way of targeting what you want it to look like. Right. Have a sense of that initially. Do tests. Play around with the pieces of software. A lot of them have trials. You can open it up and do quick little tests that way.
So we, you know, get to know what's out there, understand what your content's going to be, and find the appropriate tool to what you're trying to accomplish.
Yes.
Don't let the tool be
Don't
the
let
barrier.
It hold you back.
Yeah, exactly. So we know that the bait, we've got Flash, we've got Harmony. Those are the ones that kind of the general population in the animation world are quite familiar with. If we step one step beyond those, what's the next thing you come across in your line?
There's studios now using Cell Action. Mm-hmm. I think it's an old ink and paint piece of software. So it's kind of in line with like Toons, which is another example of a piece of software that was originally for ink and paint, some basic compositing.
So Toons became a very talked about piece of software when they made a version available for free, an open source, made it available for free online. That is the Ghibli version. Can you tell me what that is?
From my experience, we generally use it for camera testing. So we would shoot our paper on that mm-hmm. and test it out. It is a very old school approach to how you do animation. So you're talking X sheets, you're talking ink and paint in the software, basic compositing. It's probably a lot further than it was however many years ago, but it is a very basic package. It's nowhere near as advanced as Harmony, which also started out as ink and paint.
Yeah.
So the open side of things on that one, my suspicion is that it became open because they didn't have a market.
We're still Flash, we're still Harmony.
Yeah.
We're saying Toons, interesting, got a lot of talk, but really it does one thing well, and it's kind of a dated approach. And maybe if you want to be some kind of a old school cowboy, that might be the tool for you.
Yeah, if you want to do it on like pencil and paper, I mean, go for it. I'd love to see it, that's for sure.
So we touched on Cell Action.
It is expensive for the normal user.
Okay.
Yeah,
So for a casual at-home user, it's
I think it's like 1,700 Canadian. Like
really?
We're talking one of the more expensive ones with the least community around it.
Okay, so that's a con.
Yeah, yeah.
What's a pro?
They are talking to the industry, they are talking to people, and they're trying to push for more people using it. So that in itself is a pro because it means it's going to develop, it's going to become better, and they are talking to the people that use the software itself. There's nothing worse than having, like, say, another Adobe that sits on a product for 10 plus years.
Yeah.
So any communication with the people using the software is great. Having a community around it, so the more people that use it, the better the community and the more support you get.
Right.
So, I mean, competition is great. I want to see more of these pieces of software out there.
Yeah.
But right now, in that same realm, we're talking Flash and Harmony at the top.
Yeah. So where else down the chain can we go?
TV Paint is another good one.
Right.
TV Paint is another European company.
Have you used it?
I have used it.
Okay.
I've used
That's
it
good.
In a couple of capacities. So their main focus is traditional. So you're basically doing traditional on a Cintiq. And it feels like paper. It is gorgeous.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah. So Harmony, Flash, you always feel like there's a little bit of a, it's trying to refigure your drawings into vector, and mm-hmm. it kind of feels like it pops all of a sudden and isn't quite what you wanted sometimes. Since TV Paint is all raster, it's not math, it's actual pixels.
Gotcha.
It's exactly what you put down there. It doesn't feel like there's a lag. So if you're doing like a traditional approach, if you're doing a paper pencil approach, that's a great option. It is also expensive.
Yeah.
We're talking like $1,200 for a license.
That's a year?
I think that's permanent
license. Is
that a
purchase?
Yeah, it's a purchase license. And it's a weird licensing scheme. Like they give you a USB dongle still. So
oh,
you have
really?
To plug it in. And yeah. But ultimately, it works okay. really well. You're not going to get compositing. There is some options for compositing, but right. I would almost compare them to like the Photoshop filters.
Right.
Like
you
right. could use
so
them.
It's still your purely your animating tool.
Yeah.
And it's if you're looking for that traditional animation paper tool.
Yeah, I mean it is very popular in Europe and in France. A lot of the animation's done with CG
yeah.
paint. Cartoon Saloon uses it. So all their features have generally been TV paint previously. Mm-hmm. Gobelin is another example. The 2D films are using generally TV paint for those nowadays.
Right.
It feels really nice to draw on. It really does.
Yeah.
And it has a very capable timeline. So in some pieces of animation software, it feels like the timeline's kind of thrown on or secondary.
Okay.
This one's it feels like any other piece of software, like any other animation software, so Maya or Harmony. It's
okay.
it's very capable.
Cool.
The other cool thing with the TV Paint license is if you get a license, you get it on your phone. So or like an Android tablet.
Really?
Yeah. So they have this at-home version of it. So if you're wanting to draw on the phone or whatnot.
Really?
Yeah, and it's gorgeous. Yeah. They were beta testing it a while back, and I was part of that. And I had so much fun drawing on my phone on the subway, like effects animation on the way home,
wow.
just being able to draw, and it felt like paper. So that's a cool sort of side factor of the TV Paint license.
Okay.
You kind of get that with it. I don't think that's production friendly.
Right.
But
it's a little extra bonus, a little
yeah.
something for you as a drawer.
If you want to do effects on a shot and then just open it up in the file after the fact when you get into the studio, you can do it. It's the same file format. It just opens right up. And it's the exact same features that is in the full version. So it's probably one of the best pieces of animation software I've used on a tablet,
okay.
on like a personal device like that, like a phone. But the tablet version is part of the license, so you can't buy that by itself. You're talking a $1,200 app for your phone.
Right, okay, okay.
So
it definitely is, it's a bonus to the package,
yeah.
but you're saying that if you could get it as an app individually?
I would be
really?
All over that. I've contacted them, they will not separate it because it is as full featured as their main TV Paint license.
That's crazy.
Yeah, so they were afraid that if they licensed that out individually, people would just use that instead
yep.
of their...
Yeah.
It's for the people that don't want cut out.
Yeah.
They don't want to even
paper,
deal with
old school, that, but working digitally.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
Is there anything else in that area that you would really recommend, or is it like the one to use?
It's too expensive.
Yeah.
That's the
okay.
problem.
Okay.
It's $1,200 for the license, or maybe even more.
Yeah.
Sketchbook Pro is another option.
Yeah.
Because they have a flipbook built into Sketchbook Pro.
Is it any good? I mean,
it's limited. It's like I was saying, where TV Paint feels like the timeline's built in and works really well. Sketchbook Pro feels like it's kind of just another level on top of it and not tacked on.
Well, it is just
extra.
It wasn't an animation designed tool.
Yeah.
But they have an animation feature is what you're saying.
Yeah, exactly. And it's capable. Anyone that's used Sketchbook Pro knows how good it feels to draw on that. And it's really clean, really comfortable. But you're dealing with more of a limited.
How far
timeline.
Can you take something in Sketchbook Pro? You can basically just output your animation and then again you bring it After Effects or you composite it elsewhere and all that
yeah.
kind of stuff? Yeah.
You would have layers. So generally your Sketchbook Pro stuff is done in TIFF.
Yeah.
So it's like a PSD with a bunch of layers. You can still bring that into any other application,
right.
comp it. I'm not sure if you can output a QuickTime right from Sketchbook Pro, but you can always just take the frames and put them through like Premiere or anything and just create a QuickTime from that.
Right.
It wouldn't be too difficult.
Right. Okay.
There's other ones out there as well for like the phone or for macOS that I think it's called Rough Animator. And we're talking where Sketchbook Pro is $90 a year. Rough Animator is this really simple version of sort of that. But it's $10. So
really?
You're paying either, I think for Android it's $5, huh. for Mac it's $10. And it's got a really nice timeline. The brushes are very simple, but feel like paper.
Yep.
And for $10, I can't find a better piece of like traditional animation software for a phone, tablet, or Mac system.
Really?
Yeah, it's inexpensive.
So that's a very accessible, simple tool.
Yeah, it's developed by one guy, and you can email him and ask for things. And
what's it called again? Tell
us. Rough Animator.
Rough Animator?
Yeah, I use it for, once again, when the beta program of the TV Paint finished on my phone. There was a while that I would turn back the clock on my phone so I could get the beta open again, but that just got a little obnoxious. So I found I found this other piece of software, and Rough Animator is the closest thing to TV Paint that I could find. Yeah.
Okay, cool.
It's really nice, very clean drawing tools, but you're talking about doing traditional animation again. Mm. You're talking about drawing every frame, every in-between, and doing your own ink and paint. And that's something people don't quite think of when they're doing traditional animation, is that ink and paint layer where you have to click fill everything after you're done. Yeah. So
now people are animating in Photoshop.
Yeah, Photoshop has a timeline. Some people like it. I've seen some cool stuff from it.
You don't seem convinced?
Whenever it's difficult or cumbersome, like it's once again coming back to finding tools that help you produce the content and not finding tools that can do it, but it takes this extra step to do it.
Right.
If you have to do that extra step, you're usually approaching it the wrong way and it kills your flow. You want that tool to help the process and not hinder it or make you work around it. And Photoshop, I feel like that timeline, that extra little bit is working around it. Yeah. You don't have onion skinning. Flipping is a little cumbersome. It's a little slow. It's just not intuitive. It doesn't feel like it's really there for an animator. It's there for someone that wants to do consecutive frames or sequential art. But for animation,
it was never designed as an animator's tool, but it has an animate function.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. So you're working around this kind of obtuse tool at that point.
Yeah. Yeah. What about the other one that was paying for tons of advertising?
Oh, Anime Studio.
Studio. Okay, Anime Studio. Yeah, because it was popping up everywhere in terms of ads all over every animation site that seemed to be in the world.
It is a heavier piece of software, so it takes a little bit more to do what you need to do. So that always makes.
So where is it being used?
Cutout Animation's using it. Cartoon Saloon's a good example of a studio using it. They're doing a great job with Puffin Rock.
That's what they're using for that?
That's Anime Studio.
Gorgeous show. It's
phenomenal. It's really textured, and I find Anime Studio is really good at taking like a Photoshop look or a very texture approach and using that in animation. The drawing tools in it aren't great. It's not terribly intuitive, but it is coming a long way. And the benefit is that texture approach. It uses references to images. So whereas every other piece of software is trying to, it takes a file, it loads it into the file, and then it's there. Anime Studio references that off the file system, so it can use bigger files. It can it can load them in and render them as it needs it. So you can change things pretty easily. If you have a big pipeline and one guy's working on textures back here and this guy's doing the animation, he doesn't have to re-import all the textures to get it to work again.
Yeah.
And that's huge. I don't know how many times I've had to re-import mouths because the mouth chart changed, that kind of thing. So there's benefits there.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Anything else in the 2D area?
The 2D area, there's an old open source piece of software, Synfig.
Oh, right. Yeah.
It was trying to be the next Flash. It was trying to be like the open source Flash.
Yeah.
I've used it. It doesn't have much of a development community anymore. So it was being developed quite a bit for a while. It kind of lost its pace. It hasn't developed in a long while. And where it was going was very close to kind of Anime Studios realm. It was doing that morph animation. It was doing rig-based animation with sort of forward kinematics, so parenting, that kind of thing. But it's still 32-bit, so it doesn't use all your RAM. It's very limited.
Right.
And it's a lot of software that started in Linux and then goes to PC feels like it is in a different world. So it's a little scary to use at times.
Okay.
It's there. It's free. It's open source.
Gotcha.
But in that case, that's one of those that you'd have to work around the tool. It's better to pay for a tool, mm-hmm. pay the $20 a month for right. Flash than try and use something like that. Like
if you were dead broke but had your computer and you were wanted to make web animations, it would do the trick? Really?
Yeah, really.
Okay.
There's better options even for 2D. Like yeah. I've seen a lot of really cool stuff done with Blender.
Yeah.
Blender in 2D, there's this gorgeous fox animation that was really pushing how you can use 2D animation in Blender and doing drawings directly in Blender. So they're using what's basically a grease pencil that's normally done for drawovers, and they're yeah. drawing in Blender for that, for the final animation.
Okay.
And even that's really good. There's a lot of technical boundaries in Blender because you have to set everything up to work for 2D. Even 3D, you have to set up everything very technically. But I think that's probably easier than Synfig.
Yeah?
Yeah, for sure.
Wow. All right, that's saying something.
Yeah, I mean, it all comes down to how much support there is
yeah.
and how much interest there is.
Yeah.
Blender looks like a professional piece of software. It's come a huge way in the last 10 years.
Yeah.
And
I mean, the point where I lump it in with professional software.
Yeah, yeah, for sure. There's films being done with it, yeah. like feature films nowadays.
Yeah.
And the support is huge. There's such a giant community that if you need to solve something, there's usually someone to turn to get help from that.
Right.
So Blender is a good option. I don't know how ready it is to go full into a 2D pipeline,
yeah.
but for 3D, I think without a doubt, Blender okay. is a good solution.
So let's make the jump then to 3D with
okay.
that. So 3D options out there. And this is where, and I know even less about this stuff than I know about the 2D stuff. So I'm totally, this is all on you right now.
I'm a 2D guy myself.
I'll recognize the names of most of them, but I can't speak to it at all.
Okay. I mean, the obvious one is Maya.
Yeah.
Everyone's using Maya.
What's the price point like?
$180 a month, I okay. think.
Okay. So that would be considered a con for a lot of people?
Yeah. For a lot of people, $180 a month is costly.
Yeah.
The nice thing about Maya is they're probably the ones that offer the most robust personal learning edition.
Mm-hmm.
So you can just download an edition to learn from.
Okay.
So you can do a lot of work trying to figure out what you're going to
right.
do in
right.
that free version.
Okay.
And then pay for the $180 to pull it off
yeah.
for the month.
Yeah, to pull it together.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I think that's maybe a good approach for people.
And they probably know that. Like they.
Well, you can't migrate the content.
Oh.
So you wouldn't be able to do it in
okay.
the free version.
Okay, all right, well that makes sense.
But
so you can take a practice run.
Yeah, it's better to make the mistakes or learn the interface
gotcha.
In the free one, and then when you want to start paying the bucks to,
okay.
to use
okay,
the software.
Okay, that makes sense,
yeah.
But yeah. That's too bad.
It's too bad.
But it makes sense.
Yeah. So that's the obvious 3D one.
Yeah.
There's 3ds Max. Mm-hmm. People are still using for animation quite a bit. I don't know much about 3ds Max.
No.
It used to be very common for video games, and then a lot of people migrated to Maya for feature film and TV series.
Yeah.
But it's still very popular for TV series.
Okay, so Maya, 3ds Max. But 3ds Max is a more dated software.
They're still being developed.
Yeah?
Yeah, 3ds Max is still, as far as I know, being developed.
Okay.
Modo is another one. So Modo is done.
Never heard of it.
It's by the Foundry. So it's the same guys that make Nuke.
Mm-hmm.
So Nuke is really well known for compositing and feature film compositing. Modo is more so for their 3D modeling. So it's initially done for modeling, initially created to create the characters or to whatever you need to do, create props, not necessarily rigs, but it can do that as well.
Yeah.
It is getting more animation tools behind the scenes. It's more and more used in animation, but it's still primarily a rig or a modeling piece of software. So that's Modo by the Foundry.
Okay.
The other one would be Houdini.
Right.
So Side Effects is Houdini. I've used that in the past on character animation productions. But it's actually more focused nowadays in effects, so feature film effects. And that one's expensive.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that is probably the biggest hurdle in Houdini's side is it's not necessarily geared towards character animation.
Yeah.
And it's prohibitively expensive. We're talking...
We don't see a lot
yeah.
of 3D, at least for us. I mean, and it's you don't see as much casual 3D use.
No. There's so much more overhead in 3D that is ultimately the issue. But there are resources out there to produce 3D content, I think.
It does happen.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Another good example of 3D would be Source Filmmaker. So Source Filmmaker, the guys at Valve, the guys that made Half-Life, that kind of thing, created a filmmaking tool with their engine. So it's a video game engine. It all works inside the Half-Life Steam, the Source engine. And you basically can initially animate the characters in game. So you run them around as you would. And then once you've recorded the initial acting of the characters, you can go in and do character action, character animating. You can animate their facial features. You can do a phenomenal amount of stuff live, directly in their engine. And that's all free. I think you maybe have to buy a game or two to get some of the resources, but the Source Filmmaker is free and has a really good character animation system in
really?
It. Really? Yeah. And it's robust. Like, we're talking where Maya needs hours, if not days, to render content. Source is in engine. So if you want to do voice acting or character facial acting, it can be grabbed on the actual video game character's face, moved around, and you animate it there.
Is anyone using it as a filmmaking tool?
Yeah. I mean, it's one of those fan-based tools that a lot of people are doing sort of fun fan films with characters from the Valve games. But Valve themselves use it for all of their films. So like the Meet the Heavy, Meet the Sniper, that sort of thing for their Team Fortress stuff that came out a couple of years back was all done in Source Filmmaker. Huh. And they released that free. So
interesting.
I'm not sure how easy it is to get your own assets, your own resources in there. But that's a good example where it's fully featured. It has editing software built into it.
Right.
Everything is there for you to produce 3D content really easily.
All it takes is the right person to come along and decide they're going to do something with this and then to see what it can do.
And the interesting thing about that is more and more people are talking about doing video game engine productions. They're talking about doing productions in Unreal. Unity is another one that has animation built into it. So you can do character animation in Unity now. And even those companies, so Unreal, the guys at Epic are making Unreal more of a film system, but that one's fairly expensive. Unity is one that you can download generally for free. You can download the base version of Unreal for free as well, the UDK. But Unity is the more prevalent one, and you can do character animation in that. There are films out there that people are just animating directly in Unity.
So is there anything out there in the really casual app market that does anything real?
How do you mean?
Well, I mean, there's a lot of drawing, almost kid stuff, almost like, because we touched on this a little more last year because we were looking at where the real kids would play with stuff.
Okay. Is there,
I mean, like NFB has some animation apps that do interesting things and filmmakers have used them. I don't generally touch any of this stuff. So have you, in your experience, seen, is there anything for the casual animator, whatever that means?
The casual animator, I would say, the most accessible thing would be stop-mo.
Yeah.
The most accessible thing. I mean, I remember just taking a video camera and hitting on off, just take one frame manually and doing films that way. And that's a decent approach. It creates an aesthetic. So that's kind of what the NFB app does. It's very stop-mo, Norman McLaren sort of style. And it's very successful at it. As far as the kid app side, I mean, a good example of that, I mean, they probably hate that I'm calling it a kid app, is that Adobe Character Animator.
Don't worry, you can say whatever you want about that.
Adobe Character Animator, it feels like you're taking a rig and then it tries to match what you're doing. It's fun, it's facial matching, so you take a webcam and act in front of it, or you set up canned animation and it's able to reproduce it. It's not something I would do a full series in.
No.
But it can certainly provide content. It can do it if it's focused for that need. The Octocat David O'Reilly film was done in MS Paint and suited exactly what it needed to. You could produce an MS Paint film and then put it together in Premiere or put it together in QuickTime Pro, and it's still a film.
Clearly, there are a lot of options for whatever level of animator you might be. It seems as though, like, really, I mean, we do come back to those industry standards, Flash and Harmony, price point being something of difference between the two of them.
Price points, very. And I would say support. If you have friends or if you have people that you know that use one or the other, that's a good reason to choose one or the other.
Right. Moving beyond that to more traditional pencil-style animation, the front-runner seems to be...
A TV paint if you can afford it.
Yeah.
But
incredibly cost-prohibitive.
Yeah, it's a difficult one to get a hold of.
Right.
I would say SketchBook Pro is another good option.
Right.
Or Rough Animator.
Or Rough Animator.
If you want to just
Right. So Rough Animator, that's one that sounds like it would be worth checking out.
It's like $5 to $10. I can't recommend it more.
That's crazy.
I use it on a nightly basis on my subway ride home.
Okay, that's crazy. And I mean, and CG, it's a whole other thing, and generally a little more prohibitive in terms of independent animation. But if you were leaning in that direction,
it all depends on how comfortable you are with it and how prepared you are to jump through some of the technical hurdles.
Yeah.
Maya, if you have access to it,
yeah.
If you're comfortable with it, it's taught in schools, so more and more people are ready to use it. Blender is also great. The support behind Blender is substantial.
Yeah.
So I really recommend that one as well.
Cool. Yeah. Well, thank you so much for doing this with us today.
Yeah.
If you like what we're doing here today, please subscribe to our channel. I think it's down here. And like and share and tell everybody what we're doing over here.
All right, thank you so much for doing this with us, Chris.
Of course.
And we'll talk to you guys later.